Good afternoon. Nice, first try. Welcome, President Bacow, members of the Harvard Corporation and the Board of Overseers, Chancellor Merkel, members of the faculty, honored guests, fellow alumni, new graduates, friends. Welcome to the 150th annual meeting of the Harvard Alumni Association. My name is Margaret Wang, Harvard College class of 2009. And as the president of the Harvard Alumni Association, and in accordance with the tradition set out by our very first Alumni Association president, John Quincy Adams, class of 1787, I raise this gavel and call this meeting to order. The Harvard Alumni Association warmly welcomes all of you who have graduated today, the college reunion classes, and all other alumni, families, and friends who have made it here today and gathered for the very happy observance of commencement. This is by far the largest meeting I've ever led. Those who have been in my meetings know I usually like to start with a reflection question and have each person share a bit about themselves in an effort to learn more about each other and connect at a deeper level. The HAA behind me knows exactly what I'm talking about on this front. So today I thought if we started here in the front row and wove our way to the back, that might be a bit cruel given how full Tercentenary Theater is today. So instead I thought I would try something different. It's actually something a fellow Harvard alumnus recently taught me. If you could imagine, and feel free to close your eyes, I'd like for you to reflect on a moment from this past week that brought you particular joy and meaning. I know there has been a lot of activity with over 30,000 people here for commencement and 9,000 more returning for reunions. So in all the celebration convening, take some time to reflect on a moment that for you has been meaningful. Do you have your moment? Now, keep your eyes closed if they are, and I'd like for you to think back to this past year, and again focus on a moment that brought you joy and meaning. What made that particularly joyful? What led you to feel a deep sense of meaning? And now I'd like for you to think back even earlier, to some of your years growing up. For the kids out there, maybe that's just a few years back. And again, find a moment that brought you joy and meaning. Hold that one and think about what connects these three different experiences. What patterns do you see for yourself? My hope is that this is something you'll share with each other over these next few days as you experience all the pomp and circumstance of the week. And for anyone who still has their eyes closed, you may now open them. I similarly did this exercise and landed on a day I went peach picking with my family and partner David. They're actually here today, which I'm very grateful for. And I also landed on experiences related to Harvard. This past year, as I've traveled around the country and across continents, meeting those who make up our amazing community of over 370,000 alumni, I've been struck not only by the diversity of our alumni in backgrounds, interests, experiences, and perspectives, but also by how we could connect. Not only around what we all enjoy and love and agree with, but also around differing opinions and divergent beliefs. And I found my respect for this community deepen. Last year, when I addressed the senior class on class day, I mentioned Harvard being a hard thing to wrap one's arms around. It's big. It's really hard to own. I've thought a lot about it this past year in the work the Harvard Alumni Association has been doing. And I think it's because Harvard is more than just these historic and new buildings that surround these green lawns. Though on the latter, I highly recommend, if you haven't yet, to check out the new Smith Campus Center and art museums across the street. It is more than the centuries of research and thinking, and even more than all the pages combined that our graduates today have had to write or read in order to be here. It is a community where we all belong, and it can be complex and messy, beautiful and joyous, perfect and imperfect. Our community spans our new university admits all the way to our eldest alumni, many of who join us today in celebration. Leading the Radcliffe alumnae today is Evelyn Richmond of the Radcliffe class of 1941. She will actually turn 98 on Monday, so I wish her a very happy birthday. Happy birthday, Evelyn. And from the Harvard College class of 1942, Arson Charles, who celebrated his 99th birthday in February and led the Harvard alumni this afternoon. Thank you, Arson. Thank you, Evelyn and Arson, for leading our alumni parade. It is an honor to celebrate with you today. Your many years of participation in the HAA are a great reminder for our new graduates that their Harvard experience is just beginning. And indeed, your presence here today brings so much joy and meaning to us all. I would like to welcome our college reunion chairs seated on stage with us. Maybe I'll have you stand up in a bit. This to embarrass you. This dedicated group of alumni volunteers represents 13 reunion classes, including my own unbiased favorite, 2009, who are back for our 10th year reunion. And these alumni chairs lead our reunion efforts for alumni in the university. Today we celebrate the class of 1969 on their 50th reunion. Excellent. And we applaud the class of 1954 on the occasion of their 65th for attendance and fundraising records. Can I please have all the reunion chairs seated on stage stand so that we may thank you for your service? Thank you. Perhaps the great error is believing we're alone, that the others have come and gone, a momentary blip, when all along space might be chock full of traffic, bursting at the seams with energy we neither feel nor see, flush against us, living, dying, deciding. These are the words of Tracy K. Smith from her Pulitzer Prize-winning book of poetry, Life on Mars. Elected by her class in one of the most important traditions marked by all 25th reunion classes, Tracy is our chief marshal for commencement. So Tracy, if I could have you please stand. Oh, you can remain standing. Oh, you can remain standing. Oh, yeah. So Tracy is a former Crimson editor and graduated from the college with a degree in English and African American Studies. She was appointed by the Library of Congress as the 22nd U.S. Poet Laureate. She is an agent of imagination, a creator of verse that is both intimate and infinite, and who sees poetry as a means to invite us to listen to other voices, to make space for other perspectives, and to care about the lives of others who may not look, sound, or think like ourselves. It is my pleasure to recognize our Chief Marshal for Commencement, the United States Poet Laureate and member of the Harvard College class of 1994, Tracy K. Smith. And can I have the entire 25th reunion class please also join Tracy in standing and being recognized as well? Everybody was very rowdy, the 25th reunion class, yes. Congratulations. They must be so excited because we're going to see each other every 5 years from here on out. And so, exactly. So now let's turn to our newest college alumni, the class of 2019. The senior class committee, which throughout this year has brought its class together over several dozen events and is represented on stage today by First Marshal Catherine Zhang and Second Marshal Anant Pai. Under the leadership of senior class gift marshals, nearly 700 members of the class contributed to their senior gift. So can I please have the class marshals stand and be recognized? Thank you for your efforts on behalf of your class, and congratulations again to the entire class of 2019. Welcome to the HAA. On July 1st, I will pass the torch of HAA leadership to an alumna who embodies what it means to be a global citizen and has tirelessly contributed to our alumni community. Since 2015, she has made the over 24-hour journey from her home in Melbourne, Australia, to Harvard's campus for our quarterly HAA board meetings. She is a member of the college class of 1981, we have at least one, and holds a PhD from the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences and Harvard Business School. She is a former president of the Harvard Club of Victoria and former director of Australasia, in addition to many other roles on the HAA's board of directors over the years. Alice will be the first Australian and the first Canadian to lead the HAA, as well as the first from the Asia Pacific region. HAA President-elect Alice Hill, will you please stand so we may recognize you? Where's Alice? Oh, there you are. Thank you, Alice. I have deep conviction you will do a marvelous job next year. So each year at commencement, we recognize the winners of the Harvard Medal. Created in 1981, the Harvard Medal is the highest honor awarded by the university and recognizes individuals who have given extraordinary service to Harvard. This year's three recipients, who are all here with us today, merit this recognition for their exemplary and inspirational commitment to our university. Your commencement program describes the many ways in which the 2019 Harvard Medal winners have enriched the university with their service. President Bacall will read the citations, and I ask that each of the medalists please stand as your name is announced.
Teresita Alvarez Bayland. Charismatic and committed volunteer leader with boundless enthusiasm and an extraordinary talent for bringing people together, you have proudly embodied the spirit of One Global Harvard, personified a commitment to service, and inspired alumni across schools, generations, and cultures to connect with Harvard and one another. Dan Fenn. Esteemed statesman, dedicated educator, and consummate public servant whose career has spanned the Kennedy White House and the Harvard Kennedy School, you have steadfastly served the university and your class for three quarters of a century, earning a legacy as a beloved mentor, colleague, and friend to generations of alumni and faculty. I'm going to go off script here. I had the privilege of meeting Dan when I was a 20-year-old graduate student in 1972 at the Kennedy School, and it's just a great personal honor to be able to recognize him here today. Again, congratulations, Dan. Tamara Elliott Rogers. From Radcliffe College student to Radcliffe Institute pioneer to Harvard campaign pace setter, you've devoted your life to the advancement of the university's foundational values through volunteerism and philanthropy, leading a broad coalition of alumni, donors, and staff with wisdom, creativity, warmth, and just the right balance of chutzpah and humility.
Please join me in congratulating once more all of our 2019 Harvard medalists. We recently concluded the spring's elections for Harvard's Board of Overseers and elected directors of the Harvard Alumni Association, and I am pleased to share the results. This year marked the first time that eligible voters had the opportunity to cast their ballots online. Yes. Harvard degree holders cast over 36,000 ballots in the election, an increase of about 37% from last year. Thank you for doing that. Our Board of Overseers is virtually unique among governing bodies of universities because its members are elected entirely by members of our alumni community. The election for overseers began in 1866, so it has a rich history. We are grateful to all the candidates for overseer and elected director for their willingness to be of service to Harvard. Thank you to each of you who voted and participated. Please hold your applause until all the names in each category are announced. Seven exceptional individuals have been elected to serve on the Board of Overseers, and they are Alice Huanmei Chen of Berkeley, California, Vivian Hunt of London, England, Tyler Jacks of Cambridge, Massachusetts, John B. King Jr. of Washington, D.C., Reshma Sajani of New York, New York, Janet Eckelman of Brookline, Massachusetts, and Ryan Wise of Des Moines, Iowa. Five of the new overseers were elected for six-year terms. Janet Eckelman will complete the remaining 4 years of the term of Mariano Florentino Cuellar, who has been elected to the Harvard Corporation. Ryan Wise will complete the remaining year of the term of James Hildreth, who resigned from the board. Please join me in congratulating our new overseers. Next, six individuals have been elected to serve three-year terms on the Harvard Alumni Association Board of Directors. So they get to hang out and party with us. And they are Brian C. Barnhill II of Detroit, Michigan, Ethel Billy Branch of Window Rock, Arizona, Salome Cisnel de Gugart of Brussels, Belgium, Adrian E. Dominguez of Dallas, Texas, Christina Lewis of New York, New York, and Zandile Moyo of Los Angeles, California. We look forward to working with our new overseers and elected directors in the years ahead to help shape Harvard's future. Please join me in congratulating and welcoming them. To celebrate our extraordinary volunteers and our entire alumni community, please join the Harvard University Band and the Commencement Choir in their performance of Harvardiana. The words are in your program. I'm so glad the Harvard Band has the power to bring out the sun. I'm starting to see the light. It's excellent. Thank you for the hard work on that. So this past year, I had the absolute pleasure of sharing my year of presidency with a truly remarkable individual in their first year. He came to campus with a strong set of principles and values, a generous listener from the start, and like many of you in your first years here, a desire to contribute and lead in meaningful and authentic ways. Of course, this is not your usual Harvard first year. In fact, calling it his first year at Harvard is a misnomer. In addition to his two Harvard degrees, he has served on the Harvard Corporation for 7 years and has had a lifelong affiliation with our community. In fact, I think this is his 10th commencement. Of course, I'm speaking about our new university president, Larry Bacow. President Bacow has had a tremendous first year. From the start in helping our first year students move in 95 degree heat and humidity, no less, and welcoming them alongside his wonderful partner, Adele, to launching collaborations with other leading research institutions that address our national issues of economic mobility and the opiate crisis, to traveling across the country and the world and connecting with our global alumni. This year alone, he has met our alumni in and around Detroit, San Diego, Miami, Houston, Hong Kong, Tokyo, and many more. He exemplifies the pursuit of veritas, advocates tirelessly for higher education, upholds the importance of public service, and brings his wholehearted self to his leadership. It is now my privilege to introduce the 29th president of Harvard University, Lawrence Bacow. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Margaret, for that very generous introduction. First, let me say congratulations to our graduates. Welcome back to our alumni. Good afternoon to everyone, colleagues and friends and family members, loved ones, and our most special guest, our eminent speaker. It's a pleasure to address you this afternoon and to offer a few reflections as I approach the end of my first year as president. I realize, however, that I'm literally the last thing standing between you and the speech that you've all actually come here to hear. So while I can't promise to be mesmerizingly eloquent, I can at least promise to be mercifully brief. We gather this afternoon buoyed by the aspirations of our graduates, some 7,100 people who've distinguished themselves in nearly every field and every discipline imaginable. We welcome them into the venerable ranks of our alumni, and we send them forth into a world that is very much in need of both their minds and their hearts. During my brief time in office, Our world has reminded us daily of the necessity and the urgency of our work. We've witnessed the coarsening of public discourse and the volatility of national and international affairs. We've mourned when gun violence has cut futures short, and gatherings of the faithful, Jewish, Muslim, and Christian, have ended in bloodshed. We've continued to confront the existential threat posed by climate change, and we've reeled as extreme weather has destroyed homes and claimed lives. And we've grown increasingly aware of the scourge of sexual harassment and sexual assault, and have struggled to consider how institutions, Harvard among them, can prevent and address behavior that threatens individuals and weakens communities. To be sure, there is much in this world that rightly troubles us, but there's even more that gives us cause for hope. And it's that spirit of hope, the willingness both to see the world as it is and to consider how we can help make it better, is in many ways the spirit that defines this university and, I believe, joins us all together. Since I took office on July 1, I've seen the value of both knowledge and education at work in the world. I've seen the good being done by our faculty and our students, by our alumni and our staff and our friends. And I've seen expressions of compassion and patience and kindness and wisdom that have moved me deeply. I had the privilege of helping to celebrate members of our community who were recently sworn in as new United States citizens, graduates of the Harvard Bridge Program. Through their own hard work and with the generous help of volunteer student and alumni tutors, they can now enjoy the full rights and privileges of citizenship and the full sense of belonging that comes with it. It was truly an inspiring ceremony. At a time when so many people are dispirited by the deep divisions in our country, when our politics seem so dysfunctional, our graduates are taking up the cause of public service by running for office in record numbers. The world needs them, and their willingness to serve gives me hope. As Margaret noted, this past year I traveled to meet alumni who are helping to strengthen communities in Detroit and Dallas and Houston, in Miami, Phoenix, and New York, in Los Angeles, San Francisco, and San Diego, in China, Japan, and England. People who are not only launching and building businesses and creating opportunity, but people who are also teaching, volunteering, advancing important legislation, working for nonprofits, and serving the public good. I've yet to meet anyone who thinks that this world that we live in is perfect. This is not a political statement. It's equally true of liberals and conservatives, of Democrats and Republicans. And if you don't think the world that we live in is perfect, the only way it gets better is if good people work to repair it. Our students, our faculty, our staff and alumni are doing that daily, and it makes me so proud. This year, I had the privilege to meet and to be moved by not just one, but two of the nation's preeminent poets, the United States Youth Poet Laureate, our own Amanda Gorman, and the United States Poet Laureate, our own Tracy K. Smith. I've also had the chance to marvel at artists who every day breathe life into our campus with their performances and their creative work. It's amazing to see the talent that is represented on this campus and among our alumni, our faculty, and staff. And every day I've learned more about the remarkable efforts of our faculty to improve the world. Allison Simmons and Barbara Gross were making sure that the next generation of computer scientists is prepared to address the ethical questions posed by the development of new digital technologies. Ali Malkawi and his House Zero, which is demonstrating the possibilities of ultra-efficient design and new building technology to respond to the threat of climate change. Sasha Kilwald, who's revealing how marriage and parenthood affects wages in helping us understand why economic inequality persists across generations, and also how we might break the cycle of poverty. I've also come to know about the work of Connor Walsh, who's helping people with neurodegenerative and neuromuscular diseases walk again with soft exosuits that use the latest robotic technology to help improve movement. Of Sarah Bleich, who's helping to address the obesity epidemic by considering how changes in public policy can reduce consumption of high-calorie foods and soft drinks. Of Tony Jack, who's changing how colleges think about supporting disadvantaged students and improving their prospects, not just in college, but throughout life. Of Arlene Sharp and Gordon Freeman, who are giving hope to cancer patients by harnessing the body's own immune system to treat disease. Of Xiaowei Zhang, whose super-resolution imaging is enabling scientists to look inside cells with unprecedented clarity and see how molecules function and interact. Of Andrew Crespo, who's culled massive amounts of data from our trial courts to change how we think about our system of criminal justice and how we might actually improve it. I've met faculty across our schools who are expanding religious literacy, who are exploring the role of the arts in promoting justice, who are confronting the opioid epidemic from every angle, who are working to make state and local government more effective. Their work is nothing short of inspiring. And I've come to know our students, absolutely amazing students. To the parents who are here, thank you. Thank you for sending these remarkable young people to us. They are nothing short of inspiring. Interacting with them is one of the great privileges of living and working on a college campus. Adele and I have had dinner with them in the houses. We've watched them perform on the stage and on the playing fields. I've met with them during office hours and talked to them as I've gone running with them. If you spend time with our students, you cannot help but feel optimistic about our future. This past week, I had lunch with 30 graduating seniors. It was wonderful to hear how they think they have changed and matured during their 4 years here. I actually asked them, how is your current self different from your 18-year-old self that arrived here on campus? And the stories were marvelous. And I've witnessed this process of transformation myself. I helped to advise three of our incoming first-year undergraduates this year, and they helped me experience and understand Harvard through their eyes. To Andrew, Claire, and Karen, thank you for sharing your first year for me and for teaching me so well. For every person I've named, for every example I've cited, there are thousands of other Harvard citizens, students and alumni, faculty and staff, who are making the world better in more ways than we could possibly imagine. That is the power of this institution, not its brand, not our buildings, not our pomp and circumstance, as wonderful and terrific as that is. This university, Harvard, is its people, their aspirations, their achievements, their diversity of background, experience, and thought, their desire to see beyond themselves, and their devotion to serving others. So yes, I am an optimist. I'm an optimist because I live and work among all of you, because I see what you can do, and because I know the boundless potential of what you can do. May we look to one another for inspiration in the years to come. May the expectations placed on us be exceeded only by our ability to meet them, and may Harvard continue to be a wellspring of hope for the world. It's an honor to serve you as your president. Congratulations to our newest alumni, and thank you to all.
Thank you, President Bacow. I'm gonna go off script for 2 seconds and I promise it won't be terrible. But one thing that when President Bacow was just assuming his term, you know, I looked at him and I was like, okay, like, you know, I'm going into our first year together, and I was like, what do we possibly have in common? And yet the things that I ended up learning about President Bacow over this past year, that we are both, I'm a daughter of immigrants, he's a son of immigrants, we're both from these tiny towns, you know, outside these large metro areas, and he's also an avid sailor. And I was like, oh, here's a set of common grounds that actually we can be building this friendship and relationship on. And I was really excited for his leadership, and it has proved to be so much more. So thank you, truly, President Bacow, for your leadership. Onwards for more song and dance. To honor the contributions of Radcliffe College and its alumni, and to mark its historical significance for women and men alike, please stand and join in singing Radcliffe Now We Rise to Greet Thee. The words are in your program. I wasn't kidding about the dancing. Get after it. Don't worry, there'll be another song at the end if you didn't get your groove on that one. And now it is my privilege to introduce our commencement speaker. I did it, that's it. Angela Merkel is in her 14th year as Chancellor of a united Germany, and many consider her to be the de facto leader of the European Union. I said it on live stream, so it must be true. A daughter of a teacher of English and Latin and a Lutheran pastor, Angela was born in Hamburg and grew up in East Germany. As a 7-year-old child, she saw the Berlin Wall go up, and in 1989, when it came down, she crossed from East to West Berlin and began her political ascent. Equipped with the discipline of scientific inquiry and the value of data and facts from her time training as a physicist, she built her political career. During her term, she has passed Germany's first minimum wage, closed Germany's nuclear plants after the Fukushima explosion, promoted marriage equality, led progress in tackling climate change, and I know, all good things. And opened her country to over 1 million refugees from the wars of the Middle East. and giving them a chance to restart their lives in German society. She is one of our most widely respected global leaders, with formidable intellect, and as I've also recently learned, formidable wit, moral courage, empathy, and commitment to shaping not just her own nation, but our world as a whole. All, please join me in welcoming Chancellor Angela Merkel. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think let's start. President Beckau, fellows of the cooperation, members of the board of overseers, members of the alumni board, members of the faculty, proud parents and graduates. Today is a day of joy. It's your day. Many congratulations. I am delighted to be here today and would like to tell you about some of my own experiences. This ceremony marks the end of an intensive and probably also hard chapter in your lives. Now the door to a new life is opening. That's exciting and inspiring. The German writer Hermann Hesse had some wonderful words for such a situation in life. I'd like to quote him and then continue in my native language. Hermann Hesse schrieb, jedem Anfang wohnt ein Zauber inne, der uns beschützt und der uns hilft zu leben.
Hermann Hesse wrote, in all beginnings dwells a magic force for guarding us and helping us to live.
Diese Worte Hermann Hessens haben mich inspiriert, als ich mit 24 Jahren mein Physikstudium abschloss.
These words by Hermann Hesse inspired me when I completed my physics degree at the age of 24.
Es war das Jahr 1978.
That was back in 1978.
Die Welt war geteilt in Ost und West.
The world was divided into East and West.
Es war die Zeit des Kalten Krieges.
And it was in the grips of the Cold War.
Ich bin in Ostdeutschland aufgewachsen, in der DDR, dem damals unfreien Teil meines Heimatlandes, in einer Diktatur.
I grew up in East Germany, in the GDR, the part of my country which was not free at that time, in a dictatorship.
Menschen wurden unterdrückt und überwacht.
People were oppressed and under state surveillance.
Politische Gegner wurden verfolgt.
Political dissidents were persecuted.
Die Regierung der DDR hatte Angst, dass das Volk weglaufen würde in die Freiheit.
The East German government was afraid that the people would flee to freedom.
Deshalb hat sie die Berliner Mauer gebaut. Sie war aus Beton und Stahl.
And that's why it built the Berlin Wall. A wall made of concrete and steel.
Wer bei dem Versuch entdeckt wurde, sie überwinden zu wollen, wurde verhaftet oder erschossen.
Anyone caught trying to overcome it was arrested or shot dead.
Diese Mauer mitten durch Berlin teilte ein Volk und sie teilte Familien. Auch meine Familie war geteilt.
This wall which cut Berlin in half divided a people and it divided families. My family was also divided.
Meine erste Arbeitsstelle nach dem Studium hatte ich als Physikerin in Ost-Berlin an der Akademie der Wissenschaften.
My first job after college was as a physicist at the Academy of Sciences in East Berlin.
Ich wohnte in der Nähe der Berliner Mauer.
I lived near the Berlin Wall.
Auf dem Heimweg von meinem Institut ging ich täglich auf sie zu.
I walked towards it every day on my way home from my institute.
Dahinter lag West-Berlin. Die Freiheit.
Behind it lay West Berlin, freedom.
Und jeden Tag, wenn ich der Mauer schon ganz nahe gekommen war, musste ich im letzten Moment abbiegen zu meiner Wohnung.
And every day, when I was very close to the wall, I had to turn away at the last minute in order to head towards my apartment.
Jeden Tag musste ich kurz vor der Freiheit abbiegen.
Every day, I had to turn away from freedom at the last minute.
Wie oft habe ich gedacht, das halte ich nicht aus. Es war wirklich frustrierend.
I don't know how often I thought that I just couldn't take it anymore. It was so frustrating.
Ich war keine Dissidentin.
Now I was not a dissident.
Ich bin nicht gegen die Mauer angerannt.
I didn't run up and bang against the wall.
Aber ich habe sie auch nicht geleugnet, denn ich wollte mich nicht belügen.
Nor, however, did I deny its existence, for I didn't want to lie to myself.
Die Berliner Mauer begrenzte meine Möglichkeiten.
The Berlin Wall limited my opportunities.
Sie stand mir buchstäblich im Wege.
It quite literally stood in my way.
Aber eines, das schaffte diese Mauer in all den Jahren nicht.
However, there was one thing which this wall couldn't do during all of those years.
Mir meine in eigenen inneren Grenzen vorzugeben.
It couldn't impose limits on my inner thoughts.
Meine Persönlichkeit, meine Fantasie, meine Sehnsüchte, all das konnten Verbote und Zwang nicht begrenzen.
My personality, my imagination, my dreams and desires, prohibitions or coercion couldn't limit any of that.
Dann kam das Jahr 1989.
Then came 1989.
Überall in Europa setzte der gemeinsame Wille zur Freiheit unglaubliche Kräfte frei.
A common desire for freedom unleashed incredible forces throughout Europe.
In Polen, in Ungarn, in der Tschechoslowakei und auch in der DDR wagten sich Hunderttausende auf die Straße.
In Poland, in Hungary, in Czechoslovakia, as well as in East Germany, hundreds of thousands of people dared to take to the streets.
Die Menschen demonstrierten und brachten die Mauer zu Fall.
The people demonstrated and brought down the wall.
Was viele Menschen nicht für möglich gehalten hatten, auch ich nicht, es wurde Realität.
Something which many people, including myself, would not have believed possible, became reality.
Da, wo früher eine dunkle Wand war, öffnete sich plötzlich eine Tür.
Where there was once only a dark wall, a door suddenly opened.
Auch für mich war der Moment gekommen, hindurchzutreten.
For me too, the moment had come to walk through that door.
Ich musste nicht mehr im letzten Moment vor der Freiheit abbiegen.
I no longer had to turn away from freedom at the last minute.
Ich konnte diese Grenze überschreiten und ins Offene gehen.
I was able to cross this border and venture out into the great wide open.
In diesen Monaten vor 30 Jahren habe ich ganz persönlich erlebt, dass nichts so bleiben muss, wie es ist.
During these months, 30 years ago, I experienced firsthand that nothing has to stay the way it is.
Diese Erfahrung, liebe Graduierte, möchte ich Ihnen für Ihre Zukunft als meinen ersten Gedanken mitgeben.
This experience, dear graduates, is the first thought I want to share with you today for your future.
Was festgefügt und unveränderlich scheint, das kann sich ändern.
Anything that seems to be set in stone or inalterable can indeed change.
Und im Großen? Und im Großen wie im Kleinen gilt.
In matters both large and small,
jede Veränderung fängt im Kopf an.
It holds true that every change begins in the mind.
Die Generation meiner Eltern musste das überaus schmerzlich lernen.
My parents' generation discovered this in a most painful way.
Mein Vater und meine Mutter wurden 1926 und 28 geboren.
My father and mother were born in 1926 and 1928.
Als sie so alt waren wie die meisten von Ihnen hier heute, waren der Zivilisationsbruch der Shoah und der Zweite Weltkrieg gerade vorbei.
When they were as old as most of you here today, the betrayal of all civilized values that was the Shoah and World War II had just ended.
Mein Land, Deutschland, hatte unvorstellbares Leid über Europa und die Welt gebracht.
My country, Germany, had brought unimaginable suffering on Europe and the world.
Wie wahrscheinlich wäre es gewesen, dass sich Sieger und Besiegte für lange Zeit unversöhnlich gegenüberstehen würden?
The victors and the defeated could easily have remained irreconcilable for many years.
Aber stattdessen überwand Europa jahrhundertelange Konflikte.
But instead, Europe overcame centuries-old conflicts.
Es entstand eine Friedensordnung, die auf Gemeinsamkeit baut, statt auf scheinbare nationale Stärke.
A peaceful order based on common values rather than supposed national strength emerged.
Bei allen Diskussionen und zwischenzeitlichen Rückschlägen bin ich fest überzeugt, wir Europäerinnen und Europäer sind zu unserem Glück vereint.
Despite all the discussions and temporary setbacks, I firmly believe that we Europeans have united for the better.
Auch das Verhältnis zwischen Deutschen und Amerikanern zeigt, wie aus ehemaligen Kriegsgegnern Freunde wurden.
And the relationship between Germans and Americans too demonstrates how former wartime enemies can become friends.
Ganz wesentlich. Und ganz wesentlich hat dazu der Plan von George Marshall beigetragen, den er hier 1947 bei einem Commencement Speech verkündete.
It was George Marshall who gave a crucial contribution to this through the plan he announced at the commencement ceremonies in 1947 in this very place.
Die transatlantische Partnerschaft mit unseren Werten von Demokratie und Menschenrechten hat uns nun schon eine Zeit von über 70 Jahren des Friedens und des Wohlstands beschert, von der alle Seiten profitieren.
The transatlantic partnership based on values such as democracy and human rights has given us an era of peace and prosperity, of benefit to all sides, which has lasted for more than 70 years now.
Und heute,
and today,
es wird nicht mehr lange dauern, dann sind die Politikerinnen und Politiker meiner Generation nicht mehr Gegenstand des Kurses Exercising Leadership, sondern höchstens noch von Leadership in History.
It will not be long now before the politicians of my generation are no longer the subject of the Exercising Leadership Program and at most will be dealt with in Leadership in History.
Lieber Harvard-Jahrgang 2019,
Harvard Class of 2019,
Ihre Generation wird in den kommenden Jahrzehnten den Herausforderungen des 21. Jahrhunderts gegenüberstehen.
Your generation will be faced with the challenges of the 21st century in the coming decades.
Sie gehören zu denjenigen, die uns in die Zukunft führen werden.
You are among those who will lead us into the future.
Protektionismus und Handelskonflikte gefährden den freien Welthandel und damit die Grundlagen unseres Wohlstands.
Protectionism and trade conflicts jeopardize free international trade and thus the very foundations of our prosperity.
Die Digitalisierung erfasst alle Lebensbereiche.
The digital transformation affects all facets of our lives.
Kriege und Terrorismus führen zu Flucht und Vertreibung.
Wars and terrorism lead to displacement and forced migration.
Der Klimawandel bedroht die natürlichen Lebensgrundlagen.
Climate change poses a threat to our planet's natural resources.
Er und die daraus erwachsenen Krisen sind von Menschen verursacht.
It and the resulting crises are caused by humans.
Also können und müssen wir auch alles Menschenmögliche tun, um diese Menschheitsherausforderung wirklich in den Griff zu bekommen.
Therefore, we can and must do everything humanly possible to truly master this challenge to humankind.
Noch ist das möglich.
It's still possible.
Doch dazu muss jeder seinen Beitrag leisten.
However, each and every one of us must play our part.
Und das sage ich auch selbstkritisch, besser werden.
And I say this with a measure of self-criticism, get better.
Ich werde mich deshalb mit ganzer Kraft dafür einsetzen, dass Deutschland, mein Land, im Jahr 2050 das Ziel der Klimaneutralität erreichen wird.
I will therefore do everything in my power to ensure that Germany, my country, will achieve climate neutrality by 2050.
Veränderungen zum Guten sind möglich, wenn wir sie gemeinsam angehen.
Changes for the better are possible if we tackle them together.
In Alleingängen wird das nicht gelingen.
If we were to go it alone, we could not achieve much.
Und so ist dies mein zweiter Gedanke an Sie.
The second thought I want to share with you is therefore,
mehr denn je müssen wir multilateral statt unilateral denken und handeln.
More than ever, our way of thinking and our actions have to be multilateral rather than unilateral.
Global statt national.
Global rather than national.
Weltoffen statt isolationistisch.
Outward looking rather than isolationist.
Kurzum, gemeinsam statt allein.
In short, we have to work together rather than alone.
Sie, liebe also Absolventinnen und Absolventen, werden dazu in Zukunft noch ganz andere Chancen haben als meine Generation.
You, dear graduates, will have quite different opportunities to do this in future than my generation did.
Wahrscheinlich hat Ihr Smartphone weitaus mehr Rechenleistung als der von der Sowjetunion nachgebaute IBM-Großrechner, den ich 1986 für meine Dissertation in der DDR nutzen konnte.
After all, your smartphone probably has considerably more processing power than the copy of an IBM mainframe computer manufactured in the Soviet Union, which I was allowed to use for my dissertation in East Germany in 1986.
Heute nutzen wir künstliche Intelligenz, etwa um Millionen von Bildern nach Symptomen von Krankheiten zu durchsuchen.
Today we use artificial intelligence, for example, to search through millions of images for symptoms of diseases.
Und zum Beispiel Krebs besser diagnostizieren zu können.
In order, among other things, to better diagnose cancer.
Zukünftig könnten empathische Roboter Ärzten und Pflegern helfen, sich auf die individuellen Bedürfnisse einzelner Patienten zu konzentrieren.
In future, empathetic robots could help doctors and nurses to focus on the individual needs of patients.
Wir können gar nicht absehen, welche Anwendungen möglich sind.
We cannot predict today which applications will be possible.
Aber die Chancen, die sich damit verbinden, sind wahrhaftig atemberaubend.
However, the opportunities it brings are truly breathtaking.
Liebe Graduierte, es liegt im Wesentlichen an Ihnen, wie wir diese Chancen nutzen werden.
Class of 2019, how we use these opportunities will be largely up to you as graduates.
Sie werden es sein, die darüber mitentscheiden, wie sich unsere Art zu arbeiten, zu kommunizieren, fortzubewegen, ja unsere ganze Art zu leben, weiterentwickeln wird.
You are the ones who will be involved in deciding how our approach to how we work, communicate, get about, indeed our entire way of life will develop.
Als Bundeskanzlerin muss ich mich oft fragen, tue ich das Richtige?
As Federal Chancellor, I often have to ask myself, am I doing the right thing?
Tue ich etwas, weil es richtig ist oder nur, weil es möglich ist?
Am I doing something because it is right or simply because it is possible?
Das sollten auch Sie sich immer wieder fragen.
That is something you too need to keep asking yourselves.
Und das ist mein dritter Gedanke für Sie heute.
And that is the third thought I wish to share with you today.
Setzen wir die Regeln der Technik oder bestimmt die Technik unser Zusammenleben?
Are we laying down the rules for technology or is technology dictating how we interact?
Stellen wir den Menschen mit seiner Würde und in all seinen Facetten in den Mittelpunkt?
Do we prioritize people as individuals with their human dignity and all their many facets?
Oder sehen wir in ihm nur den Kunden, die Datenquelle, das Überwachungsobjekt?
Or do we see in them merely consumers, data sources, objects of surveillance?
Das sind schwierige Fragen.
These are difficult questions.
Ich habe gelernt, dass auch für schwierige Fragen Antworten gefunden werden können, wenn wir die Welt auch immer mit den Augen des anderen sehen.
I have learned that we can find good answers even to difficult questions if we always try to view the world through the eyes of others.
Wenn wir Respekt vor der Wenn wir Respekt vor der Geschichte, der Tradition, der Religion und der Identität anderer haben.
If we respect other people's history, traditions, religion and identity.
Wenn wir fest zu unseren unveräußerlichen Werten stehen und genau danach handeln.
If we hold fast to our inalienable values and act in accordance with them.
Und wenn wir bei allem Entscheidungsdruck nicht immer unseren ersten Impulsen folgen.
And if we don't always act on our first impulses, even when there is pressure to make a snap decision.
Sondern zwischendurch einen Moment innehalten, schweigen, nachdenken, Pause machen.
But instead, take a moment to stop, be still, think, pause.
Freilich, dafür braucht es durchaus Mut.
Granted, that certainly takes courage.
Vor allem braucht es Wahrhaftigkeit gegenüber anderen.
Above all, it calls for truthfulness in our attitude towards others.
Und vielleicht am wichtigsten gegenüber uns selbst.
And perhaps most importantly, it calls for us to be honest with ourselves.
Wo wäre es besser möglich, damit anzufangen, als genau hier an diesem Ort, an dem so viele junge Menschen aus der ganzen Welt unter dem Motto der Wahrheit gemeinsam lernen, forschen und die Fragen unserer Zeit diskutieren.
What better place to begin to do so than here, in this place, where so many young people from all over the world come to learn, research and discuss the issues of our time under the maxim of truth.
Dazu gehört, dass wir Lügen nicht Wahrheiten nennen und Wahrheiten nicht Lügen.
That requires us not to describe lies as truth and truth as lives.
Es gehört dazu, dass wir Missstände nicht als unsere Normalität akzeptieren.
It requires us not to accept shortcomings as our normality.
Was aber, liebe Absolventinnen und Absolventen, könnte Sie, was könnte uns daran hindern?
Yet what, dear graduates, could stop you? What could stop us from doing that?
Wieder sind es Mauern.
Once again, the answer is walls.
Mauern in den Köpfen aus Ignoranz und Engstirnigkeit.
Walls in people's minds, walls of ignorance and narrow-mindedness.
Sie verlaufen zwischen Mitgliedern einer Familie.
They exist between family members.
Ebenso wie zwischen gesellschaftlichen Gruppen, Hautfarben, Völkern, Religionen.
As well as between groups within the society, between people of different skin colors, nations and religions.
Ich wünsche mir, dass wir diese Mauern einreißen, einsam leben wollen.
Walls that keep preventing us from envisioning the world in which together we want to live.
Ob es gelingt, liegt an uns.
Whether we manage to do that is up to us.
Deshalb, liebe Graduierte, mein vierter Gedanke.
That's why my fourth thought for you, dear graduates, to consider is this.
Bedenken Sie, nichts ist selbstverständlich.
Nothing can be taken for granted.
Unsere individuellen Freiheiten sind nicht selbstverständlich.
Our individual liberties are not givens.
Demokratie ist nicht selbstverständlich.
Democracy is not something we can take for granted.
Frieden nicht.
Neither is peace.
Und Wohlstand auch nicht.
And neither is prosperity.
Aber wenn wir die Mauern, die uns einengen, einreißen,
but if we break down the walls that hem us in,
wenn wir ins Offene gehen und Neuanfänge wagen,
if we step out into the open and have the courage to embrace new beginnings,
dann ist alles möglich.
Everything is possible.
Mauern können einstürzen.
Walls can collapse.
Diktaturen können verschwinden.
Dictatorships can disappear.
Wir können die Erderwärmung stoppen.
We can halt global warming.
Wir können den Hunger besiegen.
We can eradicate starvation.
Wir können Krankheiten ausrotten.
We can eliminate diseases.
Wir können den Menschen und insbesondere den Mädchen Zugang zu Bildung verschaffen.
We can give people, especially girls, access to education.
Wir können die Ursachen von Flucht und Vertreibung bekämpfen.
We can fight the causes of displacement and forced migration.
Das alles können wir schaffen.
We can do all of that.
Fragen wir deshalb nicht zuerst, was nicht geht und was schon immer so war. Fragen wir zuerst, was geht und suchen wir nach dem, was noch nie so gemacht wurde.
So let's not start by asking what isn't possible or focusing on what has always been that way. Let's start by asking what is possible and looking for things that have never been done like that before.
Genau diese Worte habe ich im Jahre 2005 in meiner allerersten Regierungserklärung als neu gewählte Bundeskanzlerin der Bundesrepublik Deutschland, als erste Frau in diesem Amt, im Deutschen Bundestag, dem Deutschen Parlament gesagt.
This is exactly what I said to the Bundestag, the German Parliament, in 2005, in my first policy statement as newly elected Chancellor of the Federal Republic of Germany and the first woman to hold this office.
Und genau mit diesen Worten möchte ich auch Ihnen meinen fünften Gedanken sagen.
And I want to use precisely these words to share with you my fifth thought.
Überraschen wir uns damit, was möglich ist.
Let us surprise ourselves by showing what is possible.
Überraschen wir uns damit, was wir können.
Let us surprise ourselves by showing what we are capable of.
In meinem eigenen Leben war es der Fall der Berliner Mauer, der es mir vor nun fast 30 Jahren erlaubte, ins Offene zu gehen.
In my own life, it was the fall of the Berlin Wall that allowed me almost 30 years ago to step out into the open.
Ich habe damals meine Arbeit als Wissenschaftlerin hinter mir gelassen und bin in die Politik gegangen.
At that point, I left my work as a scientist behind me and entered politics.
Das war aufregend und voller Zauber.
That was an exciting and magical time.
So wie auch für Sie Ihr Leben aufregend und voller Zauber sein wird.
Just as your lives will be exciting and magical.
Aber ich hatte auch Momente des Zweifels und der Sorge.
But I also experienced moments of doubt and worry.
Wir alle wussten damals, was hinter uns lag, aber nicht, was vor uns liegen würde.
For at that time we all knew what lay behind us, but not what might lie ahead.
Vielleicht geht es Ihnen bei aller Freude über den heutigen Tag ja auch ein wenig so.
Perhaps that reflects a little how you too are feeling today, amidst all the joy of this occasion.
Als meine sechste Erfahrung kann ich Ihnen deshalb auch sagen.
The sixth thought also want to share with you is this.
Der Moment der Offenheit ist auch ein Moment des Risikos.
The moment when you step out into the open is also a moment of risk-taking.
Das Loslassen des Alten gehört zum Neuanfang dazu.
Letting go of the old is part of a new beginning.
Es gibt keinen Anfang ohne ein Ende.
There is no beginning without an end.
Keinen Tag ohne Nacht.
No day without night.
Kein Leben ohne den Tod.
No life without death.
Unser ganzes Leben besteht aus der Differenz, aus dem Unterschied zwischen dem Beginnen und dem Beenden.
Our whole life consists of the difference, the space between beginning and ending.
Das, was dazwischen liegt, nennen wir Leben und Erfahrung.
It is what lies in between that we call life and experience.
Ich glaube, dass wir immer wieder bereit sein müssen, Dinge zu beenden, um den Zauber des Anfangs zu spüren und Chancen wirklich zu nutzen.
I believe that time and time again we need to be prepared to keep bringing things to an end in order to feel the magic of new beginnings and to make the most of opportunities.
Das war meine Erfahrung im Studium.
That was what I learned as a student.
In der Wissenschaft.
As a scientist.
Und das ist sie in der Politik.
And it is what I experience now in politics.
Und wer weiß, was für mich nach dem Leben als Politikerin folgt.
And who knows what life will bring after my time as a politician.
Es ist völlig offen.
That too is completely open.
Nur eines ist klar.
Only one thing is clear.
Es wird wieder etwas anderes und Neues sein.
It will again be something different and something new.
That's why I want to leave this wish with you. Tear down walls of ignorance and narrow-mindedness, for nothing has to stay as it is. It's six things. Take joint action in the interests of a multilateral global world. Keep asking yourselves, am I doing something because it is right or simply because it's possible? Don't forget that freedom is never something that can be taken for granted. Surprise yourself with what is possible. Remember that openness always involves risks. Letting go of the old is part of the new beginning. And above all, nothing can be taken for granted. Everything is possible. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Chancellor Merkel, for those incredible words. I think it is inspirational to hear from you how we may build and imagine a world that is more connective. So truly, thank you. So no Harvard gathering would be complete without the singing of our school anthem. I know you were waiting for this. Before we close these afternoon exercises, as Her Excellency said, with every new beginning, as commencement is, some things have to come to an end. Please stand and join me now as we sing Fair Harvard. The words appear in your program. It's also your last chance to dance. On behalf of the Harvard Alumni Association, let me once again welcome and congratulate the entire class of 2019. honored guests, fellow alumni and friends, thank you for being here. Thank you for your support of Harvard. We will reconvene on May 28th, 2020, and I hereby now declare the 2019 meeting of the Harvard Alumni Association adjourned.
And with the tolling of the Memorial Church bell signals the end of Harvard's 368th commencement and the 150th meeting of the Harvard Alumni Association. Bill, we had standing room only this afternoon, and here we see Chancellor Merkel, our commencement speaker, in the blue jacket, greeting.
Standing room only, and they stood often.
Standing room only, and three standing ovations for Chancellor Merkel this afternoon. This was also the first time the Harvard's 29th president, Lawrence Bacow, was able to address the alumni. His speech could be titled, Harvard is Its People's. He gave a nod to the aspirations of today's graduates and told everyone that the world needs educated minds and hearts. When the world is in a state of change, there's a greater value of knowledge and education. He mentioned various groups. He talked at length about various professors, an economist who's working on what affects wages, a professor who's working on how colleges support disadvantaged students. He's talked about a professor who's working on bolstering immune systems as a way to fight cancer, another who's talking about criminal justice reform. And he indicated that what is truly great about Harvard are its people, their aspirations, their achievements, their diversity, and their devotion to serving others. And he talked about in a state of change, we do need graduates. In a state of dysfunctional politics that we have now, that more Harvard alumni are running for office than ever before and seeking out opportunities for public service. And it was most appropriate, I think, Bill, that our speaker today, in terms of talking about the value of knowledge, education, that our speaker was a former scientist and chancellor of the Federal Republic of Germany.
Well, and she spoke very personally today. And I think this is what she led us to believe. She gave it a context of political and science, but spoke very personally to the graduates of 2019 and imploring them, I thought, in a very logical way, but also passionate way, in the way she built her metaphor around walls and the idea that she grew up behind the Berlin Wall and that the wall did not limit her imagination. That's what she was trying to tell the class of 2019. Don't let walls limit your imagination. In fact, she implored them that she would like to see us breaking down walls. She went on to a number of other thoughts that I thought were profound, Nancy, and I think among them, she talked about technology and not having technology determine what we do, but have us determine what technology will do for us. This is a scientist telling us how to think about technology, someone who's got a worldview that we should listen to. And the politician in her couldn't be repressed and shouldn't be. She said actions must be global, not national. That she sees the world as a multilateral place. And she at those points got a number of standing ovations for her comments that were coming from the heart. This is something I think, even though it was done in interpretation, in a running interpretation of her German into English, it came from her heart. She seemed to be speaking to the graduates, to the class of 2019. I thought the moment that struck me was the point at which she actually paused and said, do not act on first impressions. Stop. Be still. Think. Pause. And that sums up for me the way she's approached her political life. And she's taken advantage, obviously, opportunities, but looked at problems that she described later, like climate change, like education for women and girls, like migration, which she received another standing ovation for her having admitted of more than a million migrants into Germany. And that has cost her politically in Germany. It is not easy for her to have done. And just to summarize the last few points, using the walls as metaphor, her life was not confined by the wall that she grew up behind. She saw open space, and it was her imagination, and that was magical for her. And that's a powerful message to send to people going out into the world, that there is magic to create, and that nothing should be taken for granted. Not peace, not prosperity that was built up after the Second World War should not be taken for granted. It's up to us to change that and to surprise ourselves by showing what is really possible. So to the class of 2019, she dressed them very familiarly. It was the way Germans refer to her now is Mutti. She's the mother of Germany, and she was speaking at some points of this speech as the mother of these students sitting in the audience. And she said, have the courage to embrace new beginnings, that everything is possible. So I'll sum up by the way she started. She started with her metaphor of walls and how powerful that was to break them down, that they're not possible. But she said, today is a day of joy. And she used her own experiences to say, it can get better and people can do more. So thank you, Angela Merkel, for such a profound insight into your person and being so open with us. I thought it was an extraordinary sharing of her personal beliefs.
And thank you, Bill, for co-hosting with me this afternoon. We've come to the end of our webcast. We will, again, be with you on Thursday, May 28th, 2020, for Harvard's 369th graduation and our 151st meeting of the Harvard Alumni Association. And, Bill, as you know, I like to close with a villanelle, a poem written by Seamus Heaney, a former poet, former professor, at Harvard, and the title of the poem is John Harvard Walks the Yard. A spirit moved, John Harvard walked the yard. The atom lay unsplit, the west unwon, the book stood open, and the gates unbarred. The maps dreamt on like moon dust, nothing stirred. The future was a verb in hibernation. A spirit moved, John Harvard walked the yard. Before the classic style, before the clapboard, all through the small hours of an origin, the book stood open and the gate unbarred. Night passage of a migratory bird, wing flap, gown flap. Like a homing pigeon, a spirit moved, John Harvard walked the yard. Was that his soul, look, sped to its reward, by grace or works? A shooting star, an omen. The book stood open and the gate unbarred. Begin again where frosts and tests were hard. Find yourself or founder. Here, imagine a spirit moves, John Harvard walks the yard. The books stand open and the gates unbarred.
Well, and with those insightful thoughts from Nancy and from Seamus Heaney, we bid you farewell and thank you for being our guest today. We've heard from two inspiring speakers, Larry Bacow and Angela Merkel, who have made this stage again a place from which history may be made with their words. And if we're listening to Angela Merkel, it will spur on our graduates of 2019 to make everything possible. Only time will tell, though. For us, though, it's been a pleasure to host you today, and we hope you enjoyed the charm and enchantment of these ancient rites. Thank you for joining us, and until next year, we bid you a fond farewell.